Welcome. I have here with me today Anouk Sleggers, who comes from Holland and is an artist. Now, Anouk, you tell me that you originally wanted to be a picture restorer rather than a painter of pictures.
Yeah, that was my plan after high school, but then the idea of my parents was there was not any possibility to make good money there and to not have a future. So I left that idea and left it for a long time. And so 5 years ago I started painting with a tutor in Malaga, Juan Bejar. And he taught me the basics of real painting, of old masters techniques. And after a few months when we finished both one of his paintings, he inspired me to continue, and he inspired me a lot to be part of contests and continue painting. So I really left his studio promising I would continue, and to be honest, that's what I did.
Mm-hmm. Well, you obviously had a very good sense for colour, so if you had gone into restoration, in fact, in which, if you're any good, there is an awful lot of money, so parents weren't quite right there, but never mind. I think you're doing very well indeed with your painting. I mean, when I first saw your work
today,
I was very surprised, and in fact, I rather wish that I still had a gallery in London. I think I would be very interested in sharing your work. In fact, you brought one along here, which I'd like to show to our viewers, and I think it's a quite remarkable piece of work for somebody who has only been painting for 5 years. Lovely sense of colour, composition, and all in all, I know you didn't want me to show it because it hasn't got a frame, but I still think it was well worth showing.
Thank you. And
may well continue to paint and doubtless improve. But you were telling me something about the Van Gogh Museum. What was all that about?
Yeah, I, on the advice of my tutor, I participated in the National Van Gogh contest in Holland. And out of 1,000 artists, I was chosen number 4.
Really?
And that gave me the chance to participate in an exhibition in the art museum where the Van Gogh paintings were.
Which is where?
In Breda.
Oh, Breda, right.
Yeah, it's in the south of Holland. And
nice little town.
Yeah, very nice. And so that gave me an enormous stimulus, a lot of attention nationally. And it opened up doors, mm-hmm. which were normally not so easy to open for me.
It's always terribly difficult problem for an artist to actually get on the ladder. Basically, because if you're going to work with a gallery and a dealer, he's got to put quite a lot of money up front to launch it. And unless he can see a return, he's not going to do that. And so it's a chicken and egg situation. You know, you don't get an exhibition unless you've got a reputation. You don't get a reputation unless you've got an exhibition.
So where do you start?
Catch 22 perfectly. Yeah. But anyway, it certainly sounds as if you were on your way. Have you got any plans for any exhibitions down in this part of the world?
Yes, I work with a group of artists in Panorama Studio 187.
Panorama Studio, where
is
that?
It's in Marbella. It's opposite Funny Beach, where the big Coca-Cola can
was,
because it's no longer there.
It's not funny anymore, is it?
It's not funny anymore, but the opposite is really funny. It's a wonderful studio where we have a big patio, mm-hmm. where we combine art with music. So we have classical music events, we have Spanish guitarists events, combined with exhibitions of the artists.
And
that,
how often
that work
does this
there.
Happen?
It happens when the weather is good, when we have access to good music, mm-hmm. Because most of the artists come from a manager which is getting big artists from New York, from London. They are willing to make their trials elsewhere, so they get used to traveling and performing. and we get them in, and that makes a wonderful combination. So people do not only get art, they get music, and sometimes we combine it even with food. So we have big art dinner, which we had last year, and it was a wonderful event.
Right, yeah. like so many things down here, we never hear about it until it's all over. Publicity yeah. does not seem to...
Well, there was quite some publicity going out there. Art is not so easy down here. It's not so easy to find the right people. I go a lot to Holland mm-hmm. for exhibition. It's a lot easier down there.
I think yeah. that's true. I mean, this part of the world has always been a bit of a cultural desert, though Malaga certainly isn't now.
No, it's
Malaga
booming.
Malaga is booming. Yeah, even the King and Queen were at the Pompidou Centre yeah, a couple yeah. of weeks ago.
No, it's amazing what they did over the last years.
And the Cat Museum yeah. is a marvellous museum
yeah,
again.
Yeah, wonderful.
And so, when do you expect to be showing at your...
Well, we start planning something. It might be in March. Mm-hmm. So it will be on Facebook of the Panorama studio. It will, of course, be on my Facebook. And, well, we were sending out emails to clients, to friends, to people who are interested in art. And another exhibition I'm preparing for is in Holland, which is the end of April.
Where would that be?
And that will be in an old school, and it will be participation with a group of artists, where we combine sculptures, jewelry, art, paintings, with music as well.
Now you were telling me, show us your eye.
Yeah. You. Yeah, those I make as well. A friend of mine makes the surroundings. It's it looks like the old. It's based on the old Victorian lovers' eyes, mm-hmm. which were sent to each other as a token of love. Later on, they put in the eye a tear as a token of mourning. So someone passed away, and an artist made them as a commission.
You don't see these very often.
No, you don't see them, and the original ones are very hard to find. You find them only at Christie's, and you pay like $20,000 dollars.
May I ask
each.
What you would charge for?
No, I charge $2,000 to $3,500, depending on.
That's a little less than $20,000.
It's a little less, but they look different. then they were painted on ivory. I paint them on very fine linen or silk. Mm-hmm. There's a difference. And then they were surrounded by precious stones, and they were really, really beautiful pieces of art.
Yes, yeah. Unfortunately, painting on ivory now is not really an option, is it?
It's not an option. It's not allowed anymore.
So, no. Which is a shame, because it's a lovely medium for holding the paint.
Right. Yeah, it's beautiful.
The paint doesn't sink in, and it sits there. And
yeah.
It gives a lovely glow to.
Yeah, it's beautiful, but that's no longer possible, unfortunately.
Well, yeah. Well, I wish you every success, and I'm sure you will
so
achieve it. And thank you very much indeed for coming along today and telling us a little bit about yourself.
Okay, thank you very much for having me.
It's been my pleasure.
Yeah, yeah, I'm here in Marbella, but. It says here I'm in La Canada.
If you haven't mastered the lingo, don't worry. Linear Director has a free GPS geolocator service that will come and find you.
Hey, hey. Hello, Marbella. And it's Amanda, Marbella Nell's agony aunt, back to say hello to you again and to bring to you a problem that's been sent in to Marbella Now and to me. Now, this problem may seem quite pedestrian compared to some of the other problems which are very serious that we've been looking at in recent weeks, but actually it is more serious and more complex than we might immediately think. Mrs. A contacted me, and she has a problem with her cleaner. And yes, we all go, oh, we've all had problems with workmen, with cleaners, with etc., etc., window cleaners. But this is different. Mrs. A has had her current cleaner for approximately 9 years. She's moved with her to two different addresses. She's been with her all the time. Mrs. A pays her very well. The cleaner was sick for some number of weeks and Mrs. A kept paying her, which I personally think is a morally right thing to do, and I'm sure you'll agree with me. But the unfortunate thing is this. Mrs. A's cleaner has a habit of breaking things and not mentioning. Not saying, I'm really sorry, I've broken this, I've broken that. And it came to a head 2 weeks ago when not only was a vase broken, but a very small, very precious ornament that wasn't worth a huge amount of money, but had belonged to Mrs. A's mother. And the cleaner didn't mention it. And so Mrs. A is in a quandary. Does she bring up the situation with her cleaner? Does she talk to her? The cleaner in every other way is great. You could leave a 500 euro note and know it's totally safe. The cleaner has Mrs. A's keys, she has her alarm code. So there is a trust there, despite the fact that Mrs. A speaks as much Spanish as her cleaner speaks English. So their communication is actually quite small. And it would be a very, very difficult situation to talk about in this mixture of languages without any real communication going on. Now, it's also a situation where you can't really involve another person to translate. It's very personal. For all we know, the cleaning lady is breaking things and is desperately embarrassed and doesn't mention it. But this is getting more and more and more frequent. And Mrs. A is wondering if it's a question of familiarity breeds contempt. There is a saying that you should change the people that work for you every sort of 5 or 6 years in order to keep that freshness going and that need to please going between both of you. Because it's an equal responsibility from Mrs. A to her cleaner as there is from the cleaner to Mrs. A. Now, it might sound that this is just a silly problem. Oh, tell the woman, please stop breaking things, which isn't actually possible. We think she's sort of basically very, very clumsy. But the fact that the breakages have increased and gone from, say, one every 3 weeks, one every month, to now virtually every week, and the fact that the cleaner doesn't say, I'm very sorry, Mrs. A, but I've broken this or I've broken that, not knowing whether it's valuable or it has sentimental value. Now, this also brings up another point in that Mrs. A feels embarrassed about confronting her cleaner. And I think a lot of us that are in the fortunate position to have people work for us in this way do feel slightly uncomfortable, especially if we've been in that situation ourselves. Mrs. A says her mother was what British would have called a charlady for many years when she was a child. And she herself, in her younger years, worked as a cleaner and didn't have many good experiences. So we know the cleaning lady is not doing the best job in the world. She's getting paid quite a high rate. She's looked after. But the same point comes out. Why does Mrs. A feel uncomfortable about confronting her? She's not physically frightened. She's not frightened that the cleaning lady is going to be untrustworthy or anything like that. But there's something inside her that finds a confrontation, which is perfectly reasonable, the confrontation that is, very, very difficult to handle. Now, this comes back to other things I've spoken about in lots of other situations with other problems, about confronting things in a non-confrontational or non-aggressive manner. And it is something we need to do. I advise Mrs. A, speak to your cleaning lady, even if you have to do it in pidgin, English, Spanish, get some communication going. Find out, is this being done accidentally on purpose? Is the cleaning lady angry with Mrs. A for some reason? But Mrs. A needs to find it in herself to say, look, please, this is enough. This was special to me and you've broken it. And the fact that she's like, go on so long doesn't help either. But she really needs to get the situation sorted out. So again, confrontation without aggression, sit and talk, and then maybe it's time for them to part ways, and hopefully in a very amicable way. So what do you think, Marbella? What would you do in this situation? What would you want your cleaning lady to do in this situation? Hopefully not break things, but you can understand that this is actually about something much deeper than just a broken vase. This is about a relationship, a working relationship that's got out of balance. And confrontation is needed, and I've told Mrs. A to be brave and actually face up to this. And face up, she doesn't have to feel guilty that she's got a cleaning lady. She pays well, she's earned the right to have that, and she needs to confront the situation and get it sorted out. Tell us what you think, Marbella. Contact Marbella Now or me at Silk and Sin and tell us what you think. We love to hear your, well, not your problems, we're very sad about your problems, but we love to hear your stories and your responses to our problems. So thank you very much, and from me again now, it's goodbye, and Nicole will be back to entertain you some more very, very shortly. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Muchísimas gracias. Espero que habéis disfrutado del programa esta tarde. Thank you so much for joining us once again for Marbella Now. We will be back tomorrow at 8 p.m. here with this TV show. But as it's Wednesday, we'll also be on 107.6 FM at 5:30 p.m. with our radio show. Don't miss it, because we have our British consul, Charmaine Arbwin, joining us, answering all your questions on Brexit. That's it for now. Take care. Be nice to yourselves, take care of each other, and we'll see you once again tomorrow. Hasta luego! And it's time.